I see dead people.
In your dreams? While you're awake?
So let's talk about this book. Spectres of Marx, The State of the Dead, The Work of Mourning, and The New International. It's a 1993 book by the Algerian-born French philosopher Jacques Derrida. Most of us just call it Spectres of Marx. It can actually be read as two separate different books. The first explains the concepts of spectres and ontology, and the second is on how Marx was haunted. We're going to focus on that first message. Derrida wrote this book in response to the question, whither Marxism? Which could mean, where is Marxism going, or is Marxism dying? The result is a book of 5 chapters. This review explains the gravity of Derrida's first message, mostly covering the first to third chapter. So we start by asking this question, what is a specter? And what does hauntology even mean? First, a specter is a paradox. It's created when we try to get rid of something which does not exist, and we cannot anyway get rid of. In trying to destroy that something, we actually incorporate it. The process of creating by destroying, in other words. Derrida calls this conjuring, or conjuring away, and he puts the away in brackets because you can't actually get rid of that thing. So with regards to communism, people have tried to get rid of it, but that only makes the idea of communism a specter, which haunts them. Karl Marx famously opens the Communist Manifesto saying, "A specter is haunting Europe, the specter of communism. All the powers of old Europe have entered into a holy alliance to exorcise this specter." Now, the powers of old Europe are the religious powers, capitalists, military powers, and imperialists. The specter of communism is something they created, actually, by trying to get rid of communism. Now, if you look around you, most of us don't live under communism, so global powers have gotten rid of something. What did they get rid of? They got rid of the body of communism, its institution and leaders. We live, after all, in a time dominated by Western liberal democracy. And so because of this, secondly, a specter is something that doesn't actually exist, at least not its body, but wants to exist, like a ghost without that body. It wants a body. So when it haunts us, it almost appears in the image of the body that it wants. He says that the specter has an impatient and nostalgic waiting. So that gives us Derrida's definition of a specter. In his words, it is a paradoxical incorporation, the becoming body, a certain phenomenal and carnal form of the spirit, which is just his way of saying it's a bodiless thing which doesn't actually exist, but is also trying to exist in the image of what it wants to exist as, and is also a paradox created by the people who want to destroy it. This also helps us understand what hauntology is. So ontology is an existing concept. It's a branch of philosophy exploring existence, being, and becoming. Derrida plays on this word to introduce hauntology, which explores the way that specters become and how they exist. Despite all of this, people still try to get rid of communism and other things. He compares these people to coroners, who are the people that examine bodies and declare them dead, saying, "But effective exorcism pretends to declare the death only in order to put to death, as a coroner might do. It certifies the death, but here it is in order to inflict it." He ends the first chapter of his text, the first chapter is called Injunctions of Marx, summarizing this idea, calling attempts to exorcise communism a restless dream. The entire second chapter of the book, which is titled Conjuring Marxism, is dedicated to explaining the misconception that communism has been defeated simply because it doesn't have a body. It becomes rather something that remains difficult to name, neither soul nor body, and both one and the other. So the next question is, if people are trying to destroy communism, why don't they just succeed? Why does that have to create a specter? For Derrida, this is psychological. It's in our minds. We feel as if communism is imminent, it is going to come in the future. It is precisely its absence in the present which makes us nervous of its potential presence in the future. Conjuring away communism is trying to make absent that which is already absent to prevent its presence. But the aspect of it which is present is the feeling that it might still come. Communism, after all, has been promised. There's no way to control the future to prevent this promise from being fulfilled. The more it is conjured away, the more it reappears to haunt those that would do away with it. It reappears as one simple thought. It's a promise that is still to come. Derrida expresses this as chasing away the spectre in order to chase after it. If one is concerned that communism might exist, they will have to keep chasing after events, institutions, or people that might cause it. So they will always be chasing after communism to chase it away. Derrida states this poetically in the fifth chapter. One chases after in order to chase away. One pursues, sets off in pursuit of something to make him flee, but one makes him flee, distances him, expulses him so as to go after him again and remain in pursuit. One chases someone away, kicks him out the door, excludes him, or drives him away, but it is in order to chase after him, seduce him, reach him, and thus keep him close at hand. One sends him far away, puts distance between them so as to spend one's life and for as long a time as possible, coming close to him again. At a deeper level, we create, then chase away, and then chase after specters. It is not there, this ghost, Derrida writes. It exists in our minds, and we are the ones which bring it there in our efforts to get rid of it. So that is what makes the specter spectral. But there's another thing to explain about specters. Our minds cannot truly understand them. When you feel afraid of a specter, are you feeling fear at the idea that it will come in the future, or are you feeling fear at the idea that it will come back? It's not clear where the source of our fear comes from, the future or the past. To make sense of this, think about it like this. We wouldn't be afraid of a specter that's appeared and will never, ever, ever, ever appear again. So if it's come and gone forever, there's nothing to fear. But if it comes and tells us it's going to be back, we have something to fear. But also, if it's never come, but we feel like it's going to come someday, then we still have something to fear. So we can either fear its first appearance or its repetition. For Derrida, our minds don't know the difference between these two, repetition and first time. We don't know the true source of our fear. All we feel is the imminence of the specter. It's not something tangible that we see before us. We don't know if it's already come and will come again. So we don't know if we're fearing its return or its first appearance. This is something Derrida calls disjointure. It means the time is out of joint or is disconnected. Derrida further explains that these two different fears are so extremely different that we cannot understand the difference. He argues our minds do not actually know the difference between any extremes, such as the difference between life and death, to be or not to be. We can understand that we are being haunted because that's what we feel, but we don't understand the nature or extremity of this haunting. This uncertainty over whether it's a repetition or a first time causes any appearance of a ghost to effectively be a first time, even if it's a repetition. This also means that first time appearances are also last time appearances. Because we cannot truly understand this feeling of the specter and its appearances, we confuse first and last, and so give its ontology or being a haunting existence, hence the word hauntology. The past specter is the one that reappears. Derrida calls this revenant. The future spectre is the one that is still to come. This one, Derrida calls arrivant. But spectres exist both in the past and the future at the same time. It is for this reason Derrida defines a spectral moment as a moment that no longer belongs to a time. By trying to destroy communism, we cause this disjointure. That's why spectres are created, after all. They are attempting to conjoin or bring back together a state of harmony. For Derrida, the definition of justice is harmony, so disjointure is therefore injustice. Therefore, injustice causes the creations of specters. Attempting to rid the world of communism creates injustice, and therefore specters. Something in the present is not going well. It is not going as it ought to go, he writes. Derrida says this is not the same thing as vengeance, quoting Heidegger, who says vengeance remains the opinion of those who equate the just with the avenged. It is common to think of specters as bringers of revenge. Instead, Derrida argues they are brought about by disjointure. The time is out of joint. So what should we do about these specters? There are some people in the world who think communism has been defeated and will remain in the past and is never coming back, but the feeling of imminence creates the idea that the specter cannot remain in some past. Derrida says the specter is the future. It is always to come. It presents itself only as that which could come or come back. Knowing this, Derrida wants us to accept the spectre and inherit Marxism, to relocate its body, recognize it, and transform it to be suitable to current times. For Derrida, it is a revolution which brings the spectre out of its image and into its body. And this revolution couldn't be more urgent. Derrida explains there's many problems with Western liberal institutions, such as economic wars, national wars, wars among minorities, the unleashing of racisms and xenophobias, ethnic conflicts, conflicts of culture and religion. He then goes on to list 10 major issues with global capitalism. 1. There just aren't enough available jobs for people. This causes social inactivity and underemployment. 2. The exclusion of the homeless and deportation of the stateless and migrant. 3. Economic war, which creates unequal international relations. 4. The contradiction of caring only about one's own economy while also trying to protect from cheap labor, which is a consequence of inequality that comes about because one only cares about one's own economy. 5. The contradiction of a market which increases the debt of the poor, thus excluding them from the very market that put them in debt to participate in. 6. The normalization of the arms trade into regular, common industries. This means ending the arms trade will lead to many job losses. 7. Countries which want to protect themselves from nuclear weapons are responsible for its spread, and states are losing the ability to control the market for nuclear weapons. 8. Inter-ethnic wars driven by nationalism, borders, and displacement. 9. Phantom states controlled by mafia and drug cartels with international influence. And 10. Most importantly, above all, the two limits of international law. The first is that it's driven by historical European philosophical concepts, and the second are the dominant techno-economic military powers that control its implementation. Derrida has a huge problem with international law and international institutions. What Derrida calls for is a profound transformation, projected over a long term, of international law, of its concepts, and its field of intervention, which requires a new international, meaning an international alliance of Marxists. Derrida wants us to adopt a spirit of criticism for present international institutions and fight for their transformation. This new international is also an end to suffering. He says, never before, in absolute figures, never have so many men, women, and children been subjugated, starved, or exterminated on the earth. Derrida does not commit to one certain interpretation of what new institutions should look like. This book is not dedicated to practical ideas for after the revolution, but instead to inherit a spirit that calls for a revolution in the first place. However, he does seem to endorse the standard formula of the Communist Manifesto, the transformation, the appropriation, and then finally, the destruction of the state, while being very critical of relying on state political party politics, which Derrida claims is reactionary and unadapted to new technological and media conditions. Derrida understands that our task is to deliver justice to the world and end suffering, but still, this task weighs heavy on us. The specter of Marx does not only haunt the imperialists, the capitalists, and the Western liberal democracy, it also haunts the inheritors of Marx. We are burdened to conjoin time, history, memory, and space. We must set things right. That is a task so heavy that it haunts us. Derrida poetically references Shakespeare's Hamlet, who felt such pressure from the ghost of his father. Hamlet does not curse so much the corruption of the age. He curses first of all, and instead, this unjust effect of the disorder, namely, the fate that would have destined him, Hamlet, to put a dislocated time back on its hinges, and to put it back right.